Jack Berry once worked as an announcer on a children's radio program. He and his partner Dan Enright then thought about building a show around kids and how they would deal with the problems and complexities of life. That show was Juvenile Jury. Hosted by Jack Berry, it aired at various times and networks in the late 40s and early 50s, and again in 1971. The Juvenile Jury episode we have for you is from the 1971 season. We hope you like it.
These children are all members of the juvenile jury. All except the big guy. That's me, Jack Berry. Welcome to Juvenile Jury.
Thank you very much. Juvenile Jury is a program where the children of America get a chance to speak their minds and their opinions, and where they meet and match wits with other children and some grown-ups, too. I'd like you to meet the members of Juvenile Jury. First of all, there is Todd Bass. Todd, how old are you?
I am six.
Well, I am delighted.
Well, thank you.
Next to Todd is Valerie Hackbarth. How old do you have, Valerie?
Four.
4 years old, and what do you want to be when you get older?
I want to be a teacher and a nurse.
All right. Thank you, Valerie. Here is Stephen Hall. Steve, what do you want to be when you get older?
I don't know right now. I have a lot of ambitions.
Tell me one.
Cartoonist.
Hey, that ought to get a lot of laughs, huh? Cartoonist. Very nice. Up on the top row with some of the older youngsters, here is Terrence Allen. How old are you, Terrence?
10.
And what do you want to be when you get bigger?
President.
That's what I like. Any child likes to start on the bottom. Very nice. Ryan Joji, how old are you, Ryan?
9.
9 years old, and what do you want to be when you get bigger?
A bum.
I know you're kidding about that, because I know you have a lot of ambitions. What are some of your ambitions?
A bum. With a lot of money.
You mean just to travel around a lot?
Right, with a lot of money.
With a lot of money. Well, that'll be the fine way to say that. Ladies and gentlemen, the juvenile jury. Nice to meet you. Each week, we'll be solving problems that have either reached us through the mails or problems that are common around many households throughout the country. You kids are going to voice your opinions in the hope that you'll offer some help to those people who are confronted with the problems. For example, here's a problem that's turning up in many households these days. Our mom has joined a women's liberation group. She marches around with signs that say, equal rights for women. Daddy thinks she's silly. He says that women shouldn't be allowed to do everything that men do, and that they should stay home where they belong and cook and sew. Who's right? Todd, what do you think?
I think the father's right.
Why?
Because they shouldn't go to a meeting. They should stay home. That's what ladies are for, to cook and sew. Not to go out to a meeting. Why do they have to go to a meeting? For like liberation, it's nothing. They have to be staying home and eating, or no cooking.
Very good. Stephen, do you think that the women's lib movement is something that should be encouraged? Who's right in this argument?
I think the man is, because the women shouldn't be out all day carrying around a dumb sign. I think that they should be at home taking care of a household job and okay. Taking care of if they have children. And just doing their everyday thing.
Fine.
Walking around the sidewalk with signs.
Very good. Parents, what do you think?
Well, I think, I think both of them are right, because one, the man is the strongest, and if the lady wants a man's job, a guy would have made her a man.
Uh-huh. All right. Valerie Hackbarth, our 4-year-old member.
What if they had a newborn baby and they have to go to the doctors to spank them and get the spit out?
Is that what you do? You go to the doctor and get a spanking?
You get the spit out from being in the tummy.
To get the what out? Oh, that's what I thought you said. All right. Brian, we haven't heard from you yet up on the top.
Well,
Well, I think the women's liberation thing is really dumb because I think they should, like, cook and sew for us, yeah.
You think the whole movement is dumb? You don't think women are entitled to equal rights?
Well, for some things, yeah, but then...
Like what?
Well, like going to meetings. I just don't think it's right.
Okay. Todd?
Well, I think if there's a meeting, like a meeting where they sew and cook, a cooking meeting, now that's fine. The husband would love that. But if it's any other meeting, no.
Well, I can tell you, Todd. I'll tell you one thing. Any prospective wife who might be looking, who might want to marry you, I think you just lost her. Incidentally, kids, how would you like it if a lady were president? Who would like to see a lady president? Valerie, Terrence, would you? Why?
Ladies should have equal rights, like me, and ladies, some ladies are smarter than some men.
Uh-huh. All right, well, we don't have time to get more of your opinions, but I bet all of you would agree that the qualified lady could be president, and I think all of you would agree, too, that women should have equal rights, by and large, as long as they can take care of their families as well. We'll be right back with interesting guests right after this message.
Being alone is so much lonelier at Christmas.
From the director of Sleepless in Seattle.
I wish there was someone who cared for me.
Comes a Christmas comedy.
Give up women, Pancho. Tomorrow he will. Ooh, that's gotta hurt.
That will put the joy back into your holiday.
My heart is racing and I'm feeling all nervous and sick.
That's the way I felt since the day I met you.
Steve Martin.
Catherine was very distressed, so naturally I had to comfort her.
Mixed Nuts, rated PG-13, at theaters December 21st.
Just a little reminder that 1 in 5 Americans will get skin cancer. The major cause is exposure to the sun. Be brighter than the sun. Call the Skin Cancer Foundation.
From time to time, we go outside the studio to get opinions from youngsters around the city and around the country. We asked a number of youngsters here in the Los Angeles area this question. What do you think the mayor of Los Angeles does? Here are the answers. They're interesting.
He works hard.
He travels a lot. Well, he travels, and he also judges the city. Travels.
Anything else?
And puts people in jail. Well, the mayor tells them what to do. He has his own desk and chair. Everybody sits around the desk and has their own chair, and the mayor tells them what to do.
What do you think the mayor of this city does?
Nothing.
And he goes straight and stuff. He collects taxes.
Puts people in jail and talks to people.
He gets people in jail that are real bad.
What do you think the mayor of this city does?
Well, truthfully, nothing, but...
He sleeps a lot because he wants to get... tell more sleep, so... He gets more pets to tell everyone more things. To do.
What do you think the mayor does?
I don't know what the mayor.
Guests who really are qualified to tell us what a mayor does. Let's welcome our guest. Mayor, I'm glad if you could spend a little time with us. Valerie, do you know what this man's name is?
No.
You don't know? No idea? Huh? Well, we think about it for a little while. What did you say, Valerie?
I have one.
Well, you have one name for him? What is his name?
Todd. Mr. Todd, certainly happy to have you with us. And Mr. Mayor, I see that we're both wearing about the same suit.
Well, I don't know. We must be over the same places.
Looks handsome on you. We are going to have a little junior press conference here. The mayor of our city has been kind enough to visit with us. We're very flattered and very pleased. And I wondered if any of you youngsters have questions you'd like to ask the mayor since he is here. Todd, what did you want to ask
the
mayor?
Well, I want to know why the taxes keep going up.
Well, I'll tell you why they go up, Todd, because more and more people are living because of the taxes paid by other people. In other words, they are not able to find jobs or not able to work, and so the rest of us have to pay taxes to support them. That is the biggest item.
Who else has a question for the mayor? Brian?
Where do you go and what do you do?
You,
over there.
You mean on his publicized trip?
Yeah.
Well, Brian, first of all, I first go primarily to the city hall, which is where the mayor has his office. And
no,
that's
where
most of the offices are. When I travel out of the city...
No, the states, I mean.
The other states? I don't go to other states very much, except to the capital in Washington, D.C., which, as you know, is not a state, but a federal district where the president has his office. But otherwise, in foreign countries, the city of Los Angeles operates a harbor, and ships from all over the world come into that harbor. And that brings a great deal of business to us, means jobs for people like all the fathers and many of the mothers. And so we go out and try and get more business for that harbor.
What do you think you do for Los Angeles?
Well, I hope that I direct it well.
Valerie?
When I saw you on Halloween, we have those white gloves and the gloves and the
Halloween. Were you parading around on Halloween someplace?
No, the only time I've had on a costume like that.
The Los Angeles Times will love to hear this.
Yeah. I was a Santa Claus once, but I've never been around with any kind of sheep.
Yes, I.
Well, I want to know if you ever travel to the White House and have conferences with them, with President Nixon and things.
Yes, I see the president every once in a while, and sometimes I see him in San Clemente, California, where he has a White House in California now.
Mm-hmm. Stephen?
If rapid transit goes through effect, how will the people get there, and when they get off, how will they get to their destination?
Well, if you have rapid transit, hopefully when people get on the car that goes very fast, there will be a place for them to park their automobiles before they get on, or perhaps even walk to the station. And then it must stop quite close to where they want to go if it's to be good rapid transit.
I think we should explain to the people around the country that here in Los Angeles, we do not have an underground system or subways. We rely pretty much on buses, and there's been a big controversy about improving that. Is that right?
Well, this is an automobile city, and it's very hard to get people out of their automobiles.
Todd?
Well, I think, when are you going to do something about the cars getting into accidents?
He's really after you, Mayor.
Well, I don't think we're going to do too much about cars getting into accidents, Todd, until we make it impossible. I don't know whether this is too complicated an answer or not, but there was a time when the men working in factories used to suffer many accidents. And we discovered that the only way to make them safe was to make those accidents impossible. And the only time automobile accidents will be prevented is when they're impossible.
Valerie?
What do you help the President Nixon to do?
Well, mainly he will ask me about problems of the city. We have a great many cities, and the cities have problems. How about Terrence?
Terrence, but I might ask a question. Terrence, the mayor doesn't want to get involved in that question too well. Terrence?
Well, what are you doing about job discrimination?
About what?
Job discrimination.
Job discrimination? We're doing a great deal about it at the city. And as far as the working for the city of Los Angeles is concerned, we have eliminated it. And also, I wish people around the country should understand, Terrence, that minority people are playing a very large part in the governing of this city. They're helping the government. They are on very important commissions. And you'd be very proud, and any minority person would, if you knew the wonderful job these people are doing for this city.
Thank you, Mayor. Brian?
What are you doing about all the pollution and the ecology crisis in the world? In Los Angeles.
Well, I'm glad you came down to Los Angeles, Brian. we have been a bit careless, I think. I say we, the people of the world, about protecting our environment. Now, I think all of you know, of course, that American men have gone to the moon and walked on it. And you probably know that in going to the moon, they had to take their own air with them to breathe. They had to take their own food with them. And everything that they need to support themselves to live while they're on the moon and there and back, they had to take with them. Now, if any of that became exhausted, if they ran out of air, they would not get back. And so you have to realize that we're all astronauts ourselves. Our Earth is whirling through space, and we have certain things here, food, air, water, to support life. But if we destroy that, then we will all just perish too. So your idea is very good. We must protect what we call the life support systems on Earth.
How do you plan on protecting...
Brian, I'm afraid that our time for questioning the mayor has run out. He has answered very adroitly all the questions, as he always does, both here and before the city council and at press meetings. And I just one more question I have to ask before we say goodbye to Mayor Samuorti. And I just found out, I went to Valerie. Now do you know who this is? What is this man's name?
Sam York.
Is right. Hey, Sam York. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. And we shall be right back after these messages.
Just a little reminder, you increase your risk of getting the deadliest type of skin cancer with just one blistering sunburn.
Hey, man.
Ow!
Be brighter than the sun. Call the Skin Cancer Foundation.
You're watching Game Show Network, your 24-hour game show source. If you have any comments, an interesting game show story, or appeared on one of our shows, drop us a line at Game Show Network, 10202 West Washington Boulevard, Culver City, California, 90232. You may hear your letter read weekdays on Club AM, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern, or Prime Game, 7 to 11 p.m. Eastern. So watch Game Show Network, the only network that lets you play along.
Young people come here and present their problems in person to the members of the juvenile jury. We have a set of twins who have a problem for us on this program. Would you give a nice welcome to the Bingley twins? Here they are.
Hi, boys. How are you? Come on up nice and close to this microphone. You are the Bingleys, and you are?
Rodney.
Rodney, and you are?
Rodney.
Rodney and Rodney, right?
Yeah.
I call you both Rod, is it okay?
Yeah.
All right, which one, and how old are you boys?
10.
And who's the older one?
Me.
How much older are you?
5 minutes.
You don't look it. Tell me about your problem. Who's going to tell me the problem?
Me.
You. Okay. Incidentally, which of you fellows is the best looking?
Me.
Which is the funniest looking?
Him.
Who's going to tell me the problem? You, Rod? What's the problem?
It's about our dog.
About your dog. What's the problem about the dog?
My brother thinks it's his and it's not mine, but it's mine and it's not his.
You have a dog, your brother thinks it's his, and you think it's yours. Mm-hmm. And he won't share the dog with you.
Right.
Right? I mean, he wants to share the dog, but you don't want to share it, is that right? Do you want to share the dog with him?
No.
What, you know, you want another dog of your own?
No.
What is the problem?
That he thinks it's his dog, and I think it's mine, but it is mine, and it isn't his.
I see. Yeah. There seems to be a little discrepancy here about whose dog it is, kids. Any questions you want to ask before we can give him any advice? Todd, what's your question?
I
I want to know why they don't share the dog.
How about that?
The reason we don't share the dog is because if we do, my brother thinks he has more than I do.
I see. All right.
Well, it won't be more because you'll both have the dog.
Yeah, but my brother takes full in charge, and then I have to feed him, and he stays and sits on the couch, and he watches me do all the work, and it's my dog.
Stephen, you have a question for the kid.
Who got the dog first? Was the dog given to you, and who got it?
I got the dog first.
Easy, fellas, one at a time. Who got the dog? Who gave the dog to you, first of all?
Awesome.
Your friend gave you the dog. Who did he give it to?
Me.
You both think you got it. All right, they both think they got it. Terrence, what's your question for the boy?
How does your dog act to both of you?
He likes me better. No, he doesn't. Because he'll fight any dog if he tries to play with me. He doesn't like him because he's too ugly.
Can you imagine one twin looking exactly like another twin and saying, "You look ugly"? Question, yes, Todd, what's your question, Todd?
Well, why don't they say any, meeny, miny, mo, and then see who it ends up at?
That might be a good suggestion. Stephen, any question for them?
Well, I was wondering who takes care for the dog.
I do.
Is that right? Does he take care of the dog?
No, he.
You take care of the dog, too?
Yes. Yeah.
You both take care of the dog?
No.
No?
I do.
You take care of the dog?
No.
Okay. No, who take care of the dog?
I do.
You take care of the dog. Brian, what is the question you have?
Well, if the dog is ugly, let him have, give it to the ugly one. And why don't you buy another a dog?
Well, in that case, I'm the ugly one.
All right. Well, kids, Todd, let's make a suggestion. Starting with Brian, you've given your suggestion, you give it to the ugly one. Terrence, what's your suggestion?
Well, Todd, the twin that the dog doesn't belong to get something that the other twin likes very much.
Okay. Stephen, what do you think about this? What should they do?
Well, I think that they should each maybe get a dog that looks exactly the same, and then they'll have fights over which one is which, and that way they can't decide, so it'd be fair.
Well, maybe that might be a good suggestion. And to help us with that, I'd like to introduce a guest from the Department of Animal Regulation here in the city of Los Angeles. Would you all welcome with me Mr. James McNamara? Mr. McNamara?
Hello, McNamara. How are you?
Mr. McNamara, I see you're carrying something there to solve the problem for the juvenile jury. Would you present it to the boys? What is that? What kind of a dog is it?
Well, this is a little husky and a little poodle. And I hope that it solves this problem. Our general manager of the Department of Animal Regulation, Robert Rush, has made this little presentation possible through private funds.
Fellas, your problem is all solved. They have two dogs. Thank you very much, Mr. McNamara. Thank you, boys. And we'll be back right after this message. Okay, buddy.
Everyone's seen the princes of the game show network.
I'm here with you watching Jeopardy. I got a secret to explain to see. I'm in love with Game Show Network TV. I'm the Wolfman. I find the game show to tell. I just love to compete. The real question is, because you're right here on Game Show Network TV.
Joker, Joker, Joker. Contestants spin the wheels for fast money and big prizes. Jack Barry hosts The Joker's Wild next on Game Show Network.
Well, our time has come and gone much, much too quickly for us, at least. And we hope that those of you at home who are watching got a few laughs, a few chuckles, and maybe some helpful information. And now, until we meet with you again next time, goodbye and good luck from Todd. Todd, say goodbye to everybody.
Goodbye, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Todd. And from Valerie Hackbar. Valerie, would you say goodbye?
Goodbye, ladies and gentlemen.
And from Steve.
Steve, would you say goodbye?
Say goodbye.
Oh, thank you very much. Clarence, say goodbye.
Goodbye, everyone.
And Brian?
Adios.
And, of course, from me, Jack Barry, with this closing thought. Out of the mouths of babes, oft times come gems. Thank you for watching. See you next time, and goodbye, everybody. Thank you.
You're watching Game Show Network. Our next show, The Joker's Watcher, debuted September 4th, 1972, which is an important one in game show history, because two other favorite shows premiered that same day on CBS. The Abbott, which lasted for 3 years, and The New Price is Right, which is still on the air. The Joker's Wild also marked Jack Barry's return to network daytime television following the quiz show scandals of the late 1950s. The Joker's Wild aired on CBS until June of 1975, then returned in syndication in 1977. Jack Barry hosted until his death in 1984. That fall, Bill Cullen took over the hosting duties until the show concluded in 1986. Now, here's one last bit of trivia for you. The original pilot for The Joker's Wild was hosted by Alan Ludden. When CBS scheduled the show, Alan Ludden was busy hosting Password, so Jack Barry ended up hosting the show. Before we start the show, I want to tell you that The Joker's Wild can be seen each morning here on Game Show Network as a part of Club AM at 9:35 Eastern Time. Here's The Joker's Wild with Jack Barry as the host. You're watching Game Show Network. From Hollywood, here's the game where knowledge is king and lady luck is queen. It's The Joker's Wild. And now, here's the host of our show, Jack Barry.
Thank you very much, and a very cordial welcome once again to The Joker's Wild, where we just crowned a brand new champion on the last program, who won $500, but he didn't get a chance to spin against the devil, which he's going to do right now, as Jay Stewart introduces our current champion.
Okay, Jack, here he is. His hobbies are photography, swimming, and scuba diving, seeking employment at the moment. It's Mike Levine. He's unemployed.
Hi, Mike.
How you doing, Jack?
You've come to the right place for unemployment. You are from New York, right?
Right.
And you were visiting here in Los Angeles?
No, I came out 4 years ago to go to school, and I've decided to live here now.
How do you like Los Angeles compared to New York?
New Yorkers haven't got a chance. California's fantastic.
Well, listen, with that attitude, you'll probably like being out of work. On our last program, you won $500, which also entitles you to come over here and spin against the devil. I have the money in my hand, and so if you feel like taking a little traveling journey, come on over here and try to beat the devil, Mike Levine. Okay, Mike. Up on the wheels now, nothing but money and devils. Every time you spin and avoid the devil, you get that money. Of course, if you go on, you take a chance. If the devil comes up, you lose everything. But if you're lucky enough to spin and accumulate $1,000 or more without ever seeing a devil, not only do you get the money, but you get these gifts as a bonus.
A Monteverdi Spanish-style stereo console. AM-FM receiver, 8-track recorder player, deluxe 3-speed record changer with precision arm and record storage well. Rich paneling dynamic sound from Monteverdi. And a library of bantam books, including Leon Ura's bestseller, Trinity. And heroic novel of Ireland, A Great and Tender Love Story. Books to read for fun, furnished by Bantam. And we're flying you to the largest of the Mariana Islands, where copra fish and handcrafts are the chief products. An island discovered by Magellan and named in honor of Maria Anna, Queen of Spain. You are going to Guam. While there, you'll be staying at the Guam Hilton, situated on 10 acres of beach, only minutes from downtown, comfortably informal, yet luxuriously elegant. The Guam Hilton, a Hilton International Hotel. This bonus round is worth almost $2,900 in cash and prizes.
How about that? Okay, if you want to Guam, you're going to have to beat that devil. You ready to go? Anybody out in the audience to root you on?
Yeah, a couple of friends from here in California.
Where are they, a couple of friends? Put your hands up over there. All up in the back about the fifth row. Okay, friends, give them some encouragement. Go ahead and spin Mike Levine. You have 150, 25, and 50. $225. As you know, if you stop right now, you got $225. I give it to you right here. Like to feel the money?
Very nice.
But you don't want it. You want to risk it? Go ahead.
I'm going to go.
He's going to go ahead. Watch out for the devil. Go ahead and spin. There you have 75, 50, and 50. Why not up? You now have $400. Do you want to quit or do you want to go on? Give him some help, friend.
They go on. I trust them.
They say go on to Guam. All right. Give him a spin. Risking $400. 75, 25, 200. I have $700. $700 if you quit right now. Are you quitting or are you going?
I'm going to go. I want to visit Guam. I'm going to go.
You're going to go. Look out for the devil. 50, 150. Whoa. Now you've got a decision to make. You have $925. I can tell you that the next spin will either get you over $1,000 and a trip to Guam, or the devil will come up. There are no alternatives about it. There's only two choices. So it is up to you. You have $75 to go. Do you quit or risk your $925?
I'm going to try it. I've never been to Guam, and I want to go to Guam.
Okay, let's hope you go to Guam. 75. Instead of going to Guam, how'd you like to go to the devil? Because that's what happened. The devil got.
Well, hey.
Hey, listen, you're a good sport. That's not the end. You may have more chances to come over here. You're winning $500. You don't get anything right now. But all you got to do is win another game. So go on over and try to win game number two. Mike Levine. It's a heartbreaker when the devil comes up. It's no fun, but that's what the game's all about. Sometimes it comes up, sometimes it doesn't. Right now, we're going to have a commercial, and then we'll be back to play our second game.
Mickey has friends wherever he goes. Not here.
Mania.
No Goofy. No Minnie. No Mercy. Mickey the Mania from Sony Imagesoft for Genesis, Sega CD, and Super Nintendo. Game systems sold separately. Also, look for Mickey Mania game tips in specially marked boxes of Cinnamon Toast Crunch.
Why does everyone love the new Game Show Network?
The emotions. They're just so contagious.
I always love just watching people stand up. It's exciting. It's fun.
I sit in front of the TV. I scream out the answers.
That's right. You're wrong.
Needlepoint is marvelous there.
Everybody wants to win.
I love to win.
Right.
Game shows is where it's at.
Tune in to watch, play, and win on the all-new Game Show Network.
Let the games begin!
Just a little reminder. You increase your risk of getting the deadliest type of skin cancer with just one blistering sunburn.
Hey, man.
Be brighter than the sun. Call the Skin Cancer Foundation.
In the course of events here in the Joker's Wild, should anybody be fortunate enough to win five games in a row? Not an easy thing to do, but it's been done many, many times. They get a bonus gift. What is that gift, Jay?
A brand new car!
It's a new kind of American car, international in design and heritage, with new efficiencies in size, space, service, and operation. The Chevy Chevette, furnished by Chevrolet.
Okay, Mike Levine's won one game. Here comes game number two, played against this challenger.
It's an executive secretary whose interests are ping pong and singing. Meet Wendy Lois Wiggins.
Executive secretary, Wendy, what company do you work for?
Oh, they sell pots and pans.
Company sells pots and pans, and what do you do for the company?
I coordinate the merchandise.
Coordinator?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can understand that. They say for every man there's a woman, so for every pot there should be a pan, right?
Right.
Pleased to have you here on Joker's Wild. Let me show you and Mike Levine the categories that are going to be used. They are the mystery category. You take that, you'll get double. All about horses, comedy trademarks, followed by the legal profession, and finally, capital. The challenger always goes first. Wendy Lois Wiggins, that's you. Spinning good luck.
Thank you.
You have the mystery category, a joker, and the legal profession.
Oh, boy. Okay, I'll take the mystery for 200.
Okay, that is 100 as it is there, but because you're willing to take a mystery category, you are playing for double. I have 7 mystery categories. Which do you prefer?
I like number 3.
Number 3. The mystery category is aviation history. Oh. You're playing this for $200. Although this man built the first successful 4-engine plane in 1914, he's best remembered for his development of the helicopter. What is his last name? Bell, Sikorsky, or Picard?
Picard.
No, I'm sorry, that's not correct. You have a chance to pick up $200. Mike, is it Bell or Sikorsky?
Sikorsky.
That is correct. You have $200. And it's your fifth. Joker, legal profession, and a triple.
I will take legal profession for 200.
What's the name of the lawyer who wrote My Life in Court and The Jury Returns? Is he William Kunstler, Melvin Belli, or Louis Neiser?
William Kunstler.
Oh, that's not correct. You can pick up $200. Is it Melvin Belli or Louis Neiser?
Melvin Belli?
Nope, it's Louis Neiser. You blew a chance to make this game even, but it's your spin, Wendy. Mystery, capitals, and comedy trademarks.
I'll take mystery for 100.
Okay, it's 50 there, but it's double. Which one do you want? 1 through 6?
How about 5?
Number 5 is called Bios and Biographies and Autobiographies. Edward Everett Hale wrote a famous biography about Philip Nolan. What was the title of the book? The Man Who Would Be King, The Man Who Changed the World, or The Man Without a Country?
Man Without a Country.
That's correct. You have $100. So 100 to 200. Your spin, Mike Levine. Comedy trademarks, Joker, and the legal profession.
I'll take comedy trademarks for 100.
Okay. Which of these comedy trademarks would you most associate with Norm Crosby? Does he specialize in malaprops, impressions of animals, or pulling gag objects out of a shopping bag?
On malaprops.
Malaprops is right. And you have another 100. $300. Your spin, Wendy. All About Horses, a pair, comedy trademark.
Okay, I'll try All About Horses for 100.
Roy Rogers' horse was named Trigger. What was Dale Evans' horse? Was it Pink Lace, Buttermilk, or White Lightning?
Buttermilk.
That's right. You have $200. Michael Levine. Comedy, All About Horses, Joker.
I'll take comedy trademarks again for 100.
You answer correctly, you'll have $400. What's the name of the comedian whose trademarks are insults, ethnic remarks, and hockey puck jokes? Is he George Carlin, Richard Pryor, or Don Rickles?
Don Rickles.
Right for $400. Go $200 to $400. Wendy? All About Horses, a pair, and the mystery.
Okay.
They're both worth 100.
I'll try mystery for 100.
Which one do you want? There are 5 left.
How about number 7?
Number 7. It's called Movie Mystery. In a famous 1959 Hitchcock mystery, Cary Grant is chased over the stone faces of Mount Rushmore. Was the name of this picture Vertigo, Suspicion, or North by Northwest?
North by Northwest.
Right for another 100. You have 300. Mike. Mystery, All About Horses, capital.
I'll take mystery for 100.
All right. There's only 4 left. 1, 2, 4, and 6.
6.
It's called Dessert. Okay. This is a $100 question. If you answer it correctly, you'll have $500. You will have won your second game and rolled your total up to $1,000 in cash. Which of the following names do you associate with brown sugar and apples? Barbara, Betty, or Bridget?
Barbara.
That is not correct. You'll pick up $100 if you give me the correct answer.
Betty.
Brown Betty, you're right. And you are at $400. And now look what's happened. It's all tied up, 400 apiece. But it's your spin, Wendy. All About Horses, Joker, and a triple. Good time to get it.
Okay. I'll try comedy trademark for 100.
You're going off the board, which you're allowed to do. You're taking the jokers and substituting the category comedy trademark. Answer this correctly, you'll have $500, enough to win the game, but Mike does get a final spin. Here are the questions. This comedian's trademarks include a sweater, a rolled-up newspaper, and biting comments on the contemporary scene. For $500, is he George Carlin, Mort Saul, or David Steinberg?
Could you repeat the choices?
The choices are George Carlin, Mort Saul, or David Steinberg.
George Carlin.
That is not correct. You could win the game, but with $500, bringing your grand total to $1,000, is it Mort Saul or David Steinberg?
Mort Saul.
Right, for $500, you win again. Congratulations, Mike. That brings your total winnings up to $1,000 in your second victory. In a moment, you'll have a chance to come back here and face that horny old devil again. Wendy Lawless Williams, unfortunately, you don't go home with a lot of money, but you do get some nice consolation prizes, and we're very pleased you're here. Let's say goodbye to Wendy Williams. We'll be back to Sin Against the Devil after this.
Jeanine woke up in a cold sweat with one thing echoing through her brain. Who was this guy in her bathroom?
Meanwhile, Barry was thinking, whose bathroom am I in?
Jeanine remembered going to the party the night before and getting smashed out of her mind.
Barry remembered getting drunk and acting really stupid.
Eventually,
the whole evening came back.
Oh, I must be really stupid.
I must be really dumb.
What did I do? How did I get myself into this?
What did I do? How did I get myself into this?
What about...
What
about Eve?
Then they both realized, much to their relief, that unlike the rest of us...
They were just cartoons.
Get high.
Get stupid.
Get AIDS.
Jay, well, we got a young man who is eager to go to Guam and give him a chance to do it with plus some money. Mike Levine, come on over and face the devil. Okay, Mike, you know the rules. You did it just a few moments ago and the devil got you. This time you'll either be more conservative or if you want to go to Guam badly enough, you'll take risks once again. All set to do it?
All set.
Okay, up on the wheels, nothing but money and devils. Go ahead and give him a whirl. You have 50, 150, and 200. That's a big one, $400. Okay, $400 right here if you quit. If you go on, you take a risk as you know. Do you quit or go on? What do you want to do?
Oh, I'm going to go.
Okay. He's going. He's determined. Here we go. $400 at risk. There you have $150, another $150, and $75. Oh, boy, you're going up fast this time. You have $775. Do you take it or do you risk it? What do you do?
I'm going to try.
He's going to try again. He could go over the top with the next spin. Here we go. He has 100. I think he did it. Yes. Congratulations, Mike. You didn't know you were over. I wasn't sure either, but it looked to me like it was over. You've won $1,100 in cash as well. First thing I'll do is maybe give this to you. Would you like that?
Sure.
Okay. You said you were out here looking for employment. Now you won't need any for a while.
The best employment I found in a long
time. I figured, huh? Here's 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 800, 900, 1,000, and 1,100. That's yours for fun. As you know, you also have the stereo music system. Do you have an apartment?
Oh, yeah. That'll come in very handy.
I'm sure it will. Sometimes invite a young lady to up for a little aperitif and...
Once in a while.
That'll be come in handy, eh?
Oh, yeah.
And then you can ask if she's read any good books lately, because you have a library of bestsellers, right?
Sure.
And then you say, how would you like to go to Guam?
Exactly.
That's what you're going to do. Well, all those things are yours. You're winning in cash and prizes about $4,000. Feel good?
Feels great.
Then go on back and play game number 3. See you in just a moment. Well, we have a winner now, 2 games in a row. The 3rd game coming up as he plays everything against this young lady.
She's from Chicago, a restaurant hostess whose interests are yoga, shooting pool, and cooking. Meet Pamela Hayden.
Hi, Pamela.
Hi.
Where'd you learn how to shoot pool?
A guy I grew up with taught me about 10 years ago.
The guy you grew up with?
A guy that I grew up with.
I see. And how good are you?
Well, I won $150 one time in a match.
That's pretty good. Let's see how much you win here. Let's take a look at the categories, which will help you win. Those categories in this game are mixed fruits, followed by poetry. Then we have films of Elizabeth Taylor and elections. Finally, meteorology. Challenger goes first, Pamela Hayden. Your spin. Good luck. Films of Liz Taylor, poetry, and a pair on Liz Taylor.
I'll take films of Liz Taylor for 100, please.
Liz Taylor portrayed Kate to Richard Burton's Petruchio in this 1967 film adaptation of a Shakespearean play. Was it A Comedy of Errors, The Taming of the Shrew, or The Merry Wives of Windsor?
That was The Taming of the Shrew.
Right for $100. In your third game, Mike Levine, your spin. Good luck. Joker, films of Liz Taylor, tripled.
I'll take films of Liz Taylor for 200.
In the 1958 film adaptation of Tennessee Williams' play, Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, what was the first name of the character played by Elizabeth Taylor? Was it Mabel, Maggie, or Myrna?
Maggie.
That is right. And you have $200. Pam Hayden. Mixed fruits, a pair, and a triple. As you know, a natural triple gets you a special bonus prize. You've just won yourself, for getting a natural triple, a set of silver plate flatware. Congratulations. In addition, you're required to answer a $200 question. You have no choice. $200 question on mixed fruits. I'm going to ask you to look at something behind me. Take a look at this. It is often said that this fruit tastes better when it is stolen. Unscramble the letters and then name the fruit.
Watermelon?
Right. You have $200 more. You now have $300. Your spin, Mike Levine. Joker, mixed fruit, poetry.
I will take poetry for 100.
Many people consider this man to be America's greatest poet. His works include O Captain, My Captain. Is he Riley, Whittier, or Whitman?
Whitman.
Whitman is right, and you have another 100. You get a $300. Four tied up, 300 feet to find out who wins the game. Absolutely.
The Lifesavers.
Believe it or not, this man's job is saving lives. Call him supportive.
In my line of work, I deal with all kinds of people. Hello. None of them are what you might call conventional.
Call him understanding.
This is all I do all day is deal with mess like you.
Just don't call him for help.
I want to die.
Matt, put you on hold.
Steve Martin.
You're a marvelous dancer. Thank you.
Mixed Nuts, rated PG-13, at theaters December 21st. Gene Rayburn talks about Match Game.
The question we were asking a contestant one day, Cuckoo Blank. Well, we thought they'd say Cuckoo Clock and Cuckoo Bird or whatever. And this woman said,
Cuckoo Friend and Ollie.
Cuckoo Friend and Ollie. Bill Daly was laughing so hard he literally fell out of his chair. We just became unglued with laughter.
Get in on the fun. Watch Game Show Network. Coming up, Clark Race tests what parents really know. The Parent Game is next on Game Show Network.
Well, we have a nip and tuck race going on, so Nip, why don't you spin? We have meteorology, a pair, elections.
Well, I don't know much about meteorology, but I'll take it for 100, please.
Okay. What do the meteorological terms cumulus, stratus, and nimbostratus refer to? The types of wind, types of clouds, or types of air conditions?
Types of clouds.
That's right, you have $400. Your spin might get in. Elections, a pair, mixed fruit.
I'll take collections for 100.
John Quincy Adams was elected president in 1824 with the lowest percentage of popular votes ever cast. Approximately what percentage did he receive? Was it 23%, 38%, or 30%?
38%.
No, that's not correct. You'll pick up $100 and you'll become the new champion if you give me the correct answer. Was it 23% or 30%?
I'll guess and say 23%.
That would be a wrong guess. 30%. Score remains 400 to 300, but it's your spin, Pamela Hayden. Meteorology, elections, and a pair.
Well, my favorite subject again. I'll take Meteorology for 100.
You answer correctly, you'll have $500, enough to win the game, but Michael gets the final turn. How fast must the wind be blowing before it can be considered a hurricane? At least 74 miles per hour, 100 miles per hour, or 124 miles per hour?
100 miles per hour?
Incorrect. You'll pick up $100. Is it 74 miles per hour or 124 miles per hour?
74 miles per hour.
That is correct. And the game's tied up again, 400 apiece. And puts you in a position where you could win the game with the right spin and the correct answer. Okay, Mike? Mixed suit, meteorology. Nope, you can't do it. They're all $50 questions. Which do you want to play?
I'll take meteorology for 50.
All right. The center of a hurricane is a calm area called the eye. Approximately how wide is this area? 1 mile, 10 miles, or 20 miles?
10 miles.
Nope. You'll pick up $50 if you can tell me. 1 mile or 20 miles?
I'll guess 1 mile.
Nope, it's 20 miles. Score remains 400 to 400. Your spin, Pamela Hayden. Films of Taylor, Joker, and Election.
I'll take Films of Liz Taylor for 100. Please.
Again, a correct answer would get you to 500, but he gets another spin. Elizabeth Taylor won an Oscar for a role in the 1960 film adaptation of Edward Albee's powerful drama. From which film did she win the Oscar? Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, Rain Tree Crowning, or Butterfield 8?
Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
No, that is not right. You could win the game with $500. Was it Rain Tree County or Rain Tree Country or Butterfield 8?
Butterfield 8.
You win the game again. Third game in a row. And we don't have time for him to spin. He's running over $4,000 in cash and prizes. We'll see you tomorrow to find out if he can beat the devil again. Bye, everybody. Thank you.
Some of our defining contestants will also receive a supply of Peppermint products, quality fish foods and care products, including Peppermint staple food, the world's leading tropical fish food, and an assortment of Thompson Natural Vitamins offering special formulas for your good health for 40 years, available to health food stores everywhere. Plus, World Book Encyclopedia two-volume dictionary containing 2,300 pages, 2,000 illustrations, and more than 200,000 entries. Also, 20 new power bathroom cleaner. It's industrial strength. Use it once a week. It wipes out soap, scum, hard water, scale, mold, and mildew while it disinfects. Plus, Heartland Natural Cereal. No artificial preservatives at all. Just the solid, satisfying flavor of Heartland. And Vicks Cough Drops, a soothing relief of cough. Vicks Cough Drops. Cool, stuffy noses, relieve scratchy throats. You can't top a drop of Vicks. And Pamela Hayden, for pulling a natural triple, you have won this magnificent gift. For truly elegant dining, this lovely Michael C. Fina silver plate flatware. 68 pieces in a contemporary deluxe drawer chest. Furnished by Michael C. Fina Company, New York City.
Following the success of the dating game, the newlywed game and shorter live shows like The Family Game and How's Your Mother-in-Law, Chuck Barris is ready for his next show. It was called The Parent Game. And I must add that the show was co-created by Game Show Network's own Gary Junkie. Originally piloted for NBC Daytime in 1969, The Parent Game hit the air in syndication for 1 year starting in September 1972. The Parent Game was the only game show hosted by radio personality Clark Race. Barris seemed to favor DJs as hosts, and no doubt due to their ability to ad-lib and to think quickly on their feet. The Parent Game was played by three married couples who had to match their ideas and views on raising children against those of a child psychologist. The psychologist in this case was Dorothy Johnson of the University of Southern California.
So let's have a look back at the parent game with Clark Race. Oh, and by the way, you may recognize the voice of the announcer as Charlie O'Donnell, the current voice of Wheel of Fortune.
You're watching Game Show Network.
Ginger's first date is over, and she knows the boy expects a goodnight kiss. But she's worried because she's never kissed a boy before. What should she do? Make up an excuse? Shake the boy's hand instead? Close her eyes? Or invite him in for a snack?
I think I'd have her invite him in for a snack. Because I'd rather eat something than kiss him.
From
Hollywood, it's the Parent Game. Here's the star of the Parent Game, your host, Clark Kent.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Welcome to the Parent Game. You know, spare the rod and spoil the child was all people thought they used to know or needed to know about raising children. But those same people also thought the world was flat and the moon was made of green cheese. Well, times have certainly changed, and we'll find out just how much as we meet today's Parent Game couples. Couple number one. They have one 17-month-old boy, Jeffrey, and they say they've already learned that all a parent really needs to raise a child is a good sense of humor. Let's meet Mike and Jerry Dukowski. Couple number two. They haven't any children yet, but they've already had some heated discussions on how they're going to raise them. Here are Chuck and Marina Mosier. Couple number three. They say that being a parent means responsibility, and they're expecting their first little responsibility in just 5 months. Here are Lewis and Tracy Davies. Those are our questions for today. Questions and kissing point value at a bonus question worth 30 points. You'll be matching your ideas on raising a family with our expert in child psychology. I'll ask all six of you. You'll have a chance to give your own individual answer to each question. And when your answer agrees with the experts, you'll score points for your team. The couple scoring the most points at the end of our game will win an exciting grand prize. And remember, these questions are not meant to be an official guidebook on child raising, but are designed more for fun and entertainment. So if you're ready at home, and parents, if you're ready, let's get started. Here's your first question. It's worth 5 points. Your 13-year-old daughter, Henrietta, asks you if she can have a co-ed slumber party. What should mom do? Sleep with the kids? Tell Henrietta no? Provide separate rooms? Or make sure they all have their own sleeping bag? Your 13-year-old daughter wants to have a co-ed slumber party. What should mom do, Mike?
No question in my mind. Tell Henrietta no. Provide separate rooms. Tell Henrietta no. That's
Mike would say Henrietta no. Sherry?
I would love to sleep with the kids, but I think as long as she's only 13, I agree. I agree. I would tell her no.
All right. Sherry agrees with Mike.
Because she would tell her no on that one.
Chuck?
Well, Sherry agrees with Mike. I agree with Sherry. I hope Marina agrees with me. I believe that you should provide separate rooms. I don't think you should call a party off for any reason. If you're there in the house, they're not going to, well, they might try something, but, you know, you're going to be there to stop it if you're a good parent and you're watching over them. And I say provide separate rooms, definitely.
All right, Chuck, that's not exactly agreeing with them, but
no.
Chuck says provide separate rooms. Marina, do you agree with Chuck?
No, this is where we start again. We always disagree. I'm going to tell Henrietta, no, I think she's too young, and I wouldn't even let her have a girl sleeping. You know, I wouldn't let her have just girls for a summer party. She's too young. I don't agree with him. I agree with them. I don't care.
No, so Marina says no. No co-ed slumber party. Lewis?
Well, I think I provide separate rooms.
No, you just wouldn't have. If you tell him he had a no, she's too young.
No, baby. We'll provide the separate rooms. See, look. No. It's like this. Okay. The boys come over and the girls come over, and then we put them in the den, and the girls in the backyard, and then they'll be...
Okay,
Louis? Provide separate rooms.
Louis says provide separate rooms.
I tell Henrietta no because she's too young. And furthermore, when we go to sleep, we don't know what they're doing when we sleep.
And who's going to sleep? Would
you
go in the house?
Oh, you gotta sit up and stay up all night.
All right, Tracy, you say.
Tell Henrietta no.
Tell them no. Mike and Shirley were the only couple who agreed with telling Henrietta no. Not one of you has suggested sleeping with the kids. What about you at home? Here's what our expert says. No matter how much parents want to be good guys, our expert says co-ed slumber parties should stop when the kids realize they are co-ed. The answer is, tell Henrietta no. Mike and Sherry have picked up 10 points on that. The most useful babies, 5 points each. Here's another 5-point question. Okay, parents, what would your advice be in this situation? 14-year-old Ginger's first date is over. And she knows the boy expects a goodnight kiss. But she's worried because she's never kissed a boy before. What should she do? Make up an excuse? Shake the boy's hand instead? Close her eyes? Or invite him in for a snack? Ginger's first date, what would your advice be to her about that first kiss? Chuck?
Definitely she should close her eyes. This is going to tell him that she's ready, you know? Now, come and get it. Now, if she invites him in for a snack or makes an excuse or shakes his hand, she's going to blow his eagle off.
What did I do?
Come. So definitely, my answer is close her eyes.
I shook your hand.
You lying? You a lying?
All right, Chuck says close her eyes. Marina, what would the advice be to Ginger? What would your advice be on her first date, her first kiss?
You know what? Close your eyes and just be scared. Just close your eyes and hope for the best.
Okay. Marina says close your eyes. Chuck and Marina agree. Lewis, your advice to Ginger.
I really can't give any advice. I've never been in the situation. But judging from the male's viewpoint, I think I'd have her invite her in for a snack. Because I'd rather eat something in it.
Lewis says Ginger should invite him in for a snack. Tracy, are you going to disagree with Lewis?
Well, me being a woman, let's see. If I was on my first date, I wouldn't let him kiss me anyway because we just, you know, had teenagers that we didn't really know each other. And especially if I've never kissed anybody before. So I think I'd probably make up an excuse, a real good excuse.
Oh, yeah, you're good at that.
Tracy would make up an excuse for Jacob. Mike, what would your suggestion be?
Well, you know, I had this problem with my wife on our first date, and she used three of the answers. She made an excuse, closed her eyes, shook my hand, I had to go out and buy my own snack. I think the logical answer.
God, you have a mouth. That isn't true.
My turn now? Okay. I think the only logical answer really is shake the boy's hand. If you invite
Mike.
Him in.
Oh, no, let me
say
this.
Mike
says shake the boy's hand.
That was to deflate his ego so badly. That's ridiculous. You can't just shake his hand.
You got to keep the challenge up.
It's traumatic.
You kept telling me that.
Oh, what did I know? I don't listen to me.
Sherry, what would you do?
I would definitely invite him in for a snack. I dated the fattest boys. I was constantly inviting him in for a snack. They were so rotund, but I didn't have to worry about it. You see?
She should shake hands, and you say invite him in for a snack. That's what Sherry said. Rather evenly split. What do you say at home? What should Ginger do on her first date? This is what our expert says. The key here is that Ginger is really worried about being a good kisser rather than being kissed. Our psychologist says the boy will know what to do if Ginger just remembers that the correct answer is close her eyes. Chuck and Marina have another 10 points, and it will be 10 points question time right after this message.
How to tell the difference between Nickelodeon videos and a large hunk of cheese.
All new Nick videos star Doug, Rugrats, or Ren and Stimpy in hilarious holiday stories. Take control. Watch day or night. Cheese won't even fit in most VCRs. The Nick videos feature video extras, more stuff like bonus cartoons. The cheese features a weird smell. And while they're both orange, the videos will never grow mold. Nickelodeon videos, they're different, and that's good.
Which child deserves to be read to? This one? Or is it this one? Which child will learn to use a toothbrush? Who will have a chance to sing? The choice is yours. Volunteer for Head Start. With your help, more low-income preschool children can get what other children already have. Change the world of a child, and you change the world.
It's time for more of the Parent Game, but first I think Charlie O'Donnell has some news for today's Parent Game couples. Charlie?
That's right, Clark, and it's good news because all of today's couples will receive a Polaroid color pack camera. Its dual features let you take indoor pictures without a flash. Its electronic eye makes perfect exposures automatically. Now let's return to Clark Race and our Parent Game couples.
Okay, Barrett, here we go, and remember this. This is a 10-point question. 21-year-old Ernest has never had a date with a girl. And Mom and Dad are getting worried. Should Dad attempt to fix Ernie up with a new wardrobe, a doctor, a knowledgeable girl, or his own apartment? 21-year-old Ernest has never had a date. Mom and Dad are trying to rectify the situation. Lewis, what should they do?
They should definitely fix that young man up with a doctor. The fellow obviously has problems. I mean, I'm 19 years old and I'm already married. Oh, no. 21? That's a shame. Young boy, too.
Lewis says fix Ernest up with a doctor. Definitely. Tracy?
Well, let's see. Ernest does have quite a bit of problems. 21 years old. That's a shame. maybe. Well, yeah, he better see a doctor.
Right. Tracy agrees with her husband. Ernest should see a doctor. Mike?
Well, I don't think it'd be a bad idea to use all four of them.
Good for you.
You're going to go with all four.
I would say a knowledgeable girl.
Oh, my, you can't do that.
What good is a doctor going to do? Is he going to be a doctor?
Every chair is here. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's going to come up with some little greener than they are. You'll have him in a mental institution.
What do you say? A doctor?
Yes, a doctor. Definitely. I think a little psychological help here and there never hurt anybody.
I think it helped with a girl.
Talk it out with
psychological help.
Mike says a knowledgeable girl, and Sherry, you say a doctor. Chuck.
Oh, definitely a knowledgeable girl. Now, a new wardrobe to start off with. A new wardrobe is going to be nice. I mean, this will get him started. But it's not going to show him where he's got to go. And this knowledgeable girl, she's going to show him where he's got to go and what he's got to do with it. And that's what she should be the one. That's my answer, knowledgeable girl.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Speaking from experience. My answer is knowledgeable girl.
Chuck says a knowledgeable girl. Marina.
It's a good thing he told me all about this before, you know, he came on the show.
What did I tell you about?
You know, about the girls and everything, because I always thought you were innocent and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Like me. I'm not going to agree. I'm going to say a doctor. I know, I think he needs help up here because, you know, 21 years old.
All right, Marina, we'll accept that. Marina says, get Ernest a doctor.
A doctor.
None of you think that clothes make the man, apparently, and forget about his own apartment.
No.
What do you think at home? Here's what our expert says. At this late stage, a wardrobe or an apartment won't help Ernie. Our psychologist says that in this case,
it might be easier for Ernie to accept help from outside the family. The answer is, fix Ernie up with a doctor.
Brace yourself for the action movie that's nothing less than brilliant. The Professional is an absolute knockout. Explosive and thrilling.
I'm dying.
A really nail-biting film. It makes speed look like a slow ride to Grandma's house. From internationally acclaimed action director Luc Besson, The Professional, rated R, at theaters now.
Mm-hmm. 2 o'clock. Okay.
Your employees who serve in the National Guard and Reserve may seem different. They may work a little harder, be more confident, more willing to make the extra effort to get the job done right. So when your employees need time off to serve, remember, it's not just good for our country. It's good for your business.
Glad you could all make it.
Welcome back. And here we go with a 15-point question. Progressive Aunt Sadie gives your 8-year-old daughter, Lisa, a fully illustrated children's book on the facts of life. Parents, what are you going to do? Exchange it for another book? Cut out the pictures? Put it away until she's older? Or read her a chapter a night? Aunt Sadie has given your 8-year-old daughter, Lisa, a fully illustrated children's book on the facts of life. Mike?
That's a rough question. Cutting out the pictures might be good for old dad, but I don't think it's going to help the daughter. I'd say put it away until she's older. I think that 8, even in today's progressive society, is a little young for fully illustrated facts of life. I think the questions about sex, is that okay to say? sex is are fine when they come from the child rather than being prompted and pushed upon it. I'd say put it away until she's older.
Good boy, Mike.
I think sex is mild after what's been going on. Very mild, Mike. So you say put it away for another day. Sherry?
Would you believe I really agree with them? I think that 8 is a little bit with the fully illustrated. I mean, if it were like a Dr. Seuss thing with, you know, CBD, that is fine. But this is a fully illustrated book, and I really think she should be a little older. She's a little young.
All right. Sherry agrees with Mike. Put it away for another day until she's older. Chuck?
Well, first of all,
Aunt
Sadie is going to read her a chapter a night, and she's progressive. But I don't think I would do that. For the simple reason that
I'll kill you.
That my wife would kill me. No, it's too young. 8 years. You really don't know what you're
what
doing.
Would you do then, Chuck?
At 9 years old, yes, but not at 8. I'd put it away until she's older.
Chuck would put it away until she's older. Marina.
You know, it's a good night tonight because we're going to agree. I think she's too young. You know, usually we don't ever agree on anything. I mean, nothing. And tonight we're agreeing a lot. I was like, put it away until she's older because she's too young to
Marina
know.
Marina says put it away until she's older.
Nice.
So the Kukowskis and the Mosiers agree so far. Lewis?
It doesn't say anything in that particular answer about the pictures. I'd read her a chapter at night. I don't have to show her the pictures.
No, you would not. Hey. Girl, 8 years old, you
would. I'll read it to her. Right. That's a least she'll know about
it.
Well, nevertheless, I'll read her a chapter tonight. I'll look at the pictures and I'll turn her. Okay.
Excellent
bedtime
story for her.
Oh,
Lewis can read her a chapter a night.
Right.
Tracy.
I put it away until she's older because a little girl, 8 years old, isn't going to know what I'm saying. If I'm reading it to her, she wouldn't understand the words and she wouldn't understand the illustrations.
I would.
All right, Tracy would put it away until she's older. That's what the majority of you think, all except Lewis. Y'all may be surprised. What do you think at home? Here's what our expert says. Though this may not be your selection for the book of the month, Our expert says if handled the right way, an 8-year-old can benefit from the experience. The answer is, read her a chapter a night. And that was for 15 points. Lewis and Tracy Davies have 40 points. And now it's time for your 30-point bonus question. Each team will have 30 seconds to discuss the question out loud, and at the end of that time, come up with just one answer between them, and please hold your discussions until I call on you. Now, here's that big bonus question. Should parents allow their children to call them by their first names? Yes. No. When it's appropriate. Or it makes no difference. Should parents allow their children to call them by their first names? Lewis and Tracy Davies, you're ahead. You'll have 30 seconds to discuss it and one answer between you. Go ahead.
I don't know.
Seriously.
I don't think I
like
to call
you. Well, you know, it has something to do with respect, you know.
Yeah.
Somebody, you know, you look out. Hey, Lou, look here. Let me have $20. Yeah, that is. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
with this society, I might be, hey, son, let me have $20. I don't know.
Yeah.
How it would work, one way or the other.
I think
no. All right, we need that one answer, though.
We do have to discuss that.
What is it?
No.
All right. Lewis and Tracy Davies say no. Chuck and Marina, you'll have 30 seconds to discuss it. One answer between you.
Okay. No.
You agree it doesn't make any difference?
No.
Right?
No.
You don't agree that it doesn't.
Yeah, I don't agree. I think it's not.
Yeah.
I believe in respect too, because I've never called my mom. You know. Oh,
no, definitely.
No, I say no. Say no. Okay. No.
Okay. No.
That's right. That one answer, Chuck and Marina.
What? No.
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 All right, Chuck and Marina. Both you say no. Mike and Sherry, you'll have 30 seconds for open discussion and one answer.
I think the respect is important with the mom and dad, but I think that there are certain times when it's appropriate to say, to call them.
Well, the problem here is we don't know really how old the children are.
Yeah,
you know, if they're 4 and 5 years old.
You work with your dad and you call them by his first name sometimes. I think when it's appropriate. Don't you agree?
I would agree with that. I think there are certain situations.
When it's appropriate. You know, in certain situations, referring to them. I think, you know, it might be appropriate.
Mike and Sherry,
when it's appropriate.
When it's appropriate. All of our answers are in. We'll be right back with the correct answer and find out which couple wins our grand prize today on the Parrot Game. But first, this message.
Why are game shows everyone's favorite television?
These shows are so incredible. There's so much energy.
This is so cool.
What a show.
You jump when they jump and you laugh when they do something stupid.
I love watching the old celebrities like Ginger Rogers, Jerry Lewis. She's hilarious.
Elizabeth Taylor, she's a beautiful woman. I can help you tell me.
Bob Hope, Groucho Marx.
Roger Hood.
I can watch them all night long.
Tune in to watch, play, and win on the all-new Game Show Network.
He protects all living things in the forest. But he can't do it alone. Please don't play with matches. Put out your campfires. And never, ever forget the words of Smokey Bear.
Only you could prevent forest fires.
Up next, Gene Rayburn and 6 celebrities match wits for big money. The Match Game is next on Game Show Network, America's favorite place to watch, play, and win.
Welcome back to the Parrot Game. Remember the 30-point bonus question, which could decide the grand prize winner was, should parents allow their children to call them by their first names? Yes, no, when it's appropriate, or it makes no difference. Couple number one, Mike and Sherry Dukofsky said, when it's appropriate. Couple number two, Chuck and Marina Mosier said, no. Couple number three, Lewis and Tracy Davies said, no. Now, for 30 points, let's see what our expert says. Our psychologist reminds us that today's kids are growing up faster and parents are making a real effort to keep tuned in to their needs. But what kids need at home are not buddies, but parents. The answer is definitely no. And that means that couple number three, Lewis and Tracy Davies, are our grand prize winners for today. And there are some great times in store for your family. From now on, it's going to be stop looking, listen, driver. Because the grand prize you've just won is a pair of luxurious lounge chairs, an individually designed console piano, and a beautiful new color television set.
Right, Lewis and Tracy Davies.
crazy it is. Stop looking at some time. And you'll really enjoy that stop when you report to your company, Mr. and Mrs. Longchamp. And you won't find anything better to listen to than your story in part piano with a superior tone exclusive story sounding board that's guaranteed for 50 years. And here's that nothing to look at. A 23-inch RCA cult slow color television set featuring RCA's exclusive computer-crafted color. Truly a home entertainment bonanza. And it's all yours as today's winners of the Parent Game.
That's it for today. Continue with us. This is Bart Gray saying it's nice to know so many nice people. Goodbye.
The Parent Game is a Chuck Barris show.
You're watching Game Show Network.
One of Britson Todman Productions' most successful shows is Match Game. The original Match Game ran on NBC from 1962 to 1969. A more comedy-driven Match Game returned on CBS July 2nd, 1973, with the title Match Game 73. Pretty clever. Hosted as before by Gene Rayburn. Contestants had to match responses with six celebrities, and quite often the answers were humorous and even a little suggestive. Sometimes the answers were hysterically off-base, like the time a contestant answered the super match Cuckoo Blank with Cuckoo Friend and Ollie, as opposed to Kukla Fran and Ollie. Pretty funny. You had to be there. A regular panelist for Match Game included Brett Summers, Charles Nelson Reilly, and Richard Dawson, who left in 1976 to host Family Feud. Match Game changed its title each January 1st and always had an on-air ceremony of ringing in the new year with a new sign on the set. Match Game 79 was the last year the show aired on CBS. However, it didn't miss a beat in continuing its syndication until 1982. There was also a nighttime syndicated version called Match Game PM that aired from 1975 to 1981. Match Game then reappeared in 1983 as a hybrid of two classic shows, the Match Game Hollywood Squares Hour. ABC then brought Match Game back for one season in 1990, hosted by Ross Shaker. Now you know almost everything you ever wanted to know about Match Game. The last thing you need to know is that you can see Match Game not once, not twice, folks, but three times a day on Game Show Network. Match Game with Ross Schaefer Monday through Friday during Club AM at 12:30 p.m. Eastern, and Match Game with Gene Rayburn at 4 p.m. Eastern, and during Prime Games at 7 p.m. Eastern time each week night. Now you know everything. So let's have a look at an episode from blank. Oh. Okay, I'll tell you. It was originally seen on CBS in 1973, which would make it Match Game 73, yeah.
Get ready to match the stars. Nipsey Russell. Brett Summers. Charles Nelson Reilly. Beverly Garland. Richard Dawson and Betty White as we play the star-studded Big Money Match Game 73. And now here's the host of Match Game 73, Gene Rayburn.
Hello, guys. Are you ready? I'm not.
I'd like to thank all of you for being here. Because without you, we'd be nothing.
We'd like to thank you for thanking us.
Okay. No, I mean that. You know, this show is really a big hit. And you're responsible. And you're responsible. You're and a
I'm
lot
not
of people
responsible
are
responsible for this show.
You're not? No, sir. Okay, don't blame Nipsey.
Right.
Are you still on that funny cough medicine?
That's it. I'm taking it all away.
My clothes have improved since the show's gone.
And you've changed your hair.
Your wig.
All right, let's have it. Let's have a quick vote among the celebrities. If you like today's wig, raise your right hand. And you like yesterday's wig? You don't like either wig. All right. Why don't you wear your own hair?
I don't have any.
Yes, you do.
She told
us. Listen, let's welcome our two players here, Brooke Walker and Olivia Lenke.
Olivia's our current champ. Well, your friend?
Her friend? I do, anyway. Olivia's a current champ. She won $1,550, and she was challenged by Brooke Walker. The game ended in a tie. Just as our time expired last time, we were ready to go to a tiebreaker, and we're going to do that in a moment or so. You ready for that, ladies? Okay, the tiebreaker coming up right after this.
Everyone's seen the Princes of the Game Show Network.
I'm with you watching Jeopardy. I got a secret and it's plain to see. I'm in love with Game Show Network TV. I'm with the whole man, my heart is giving to me to tell the truth. I just love to convey the wheel of watching you spin for me. Cause you're right here on Game Show Network TV. Please be
All right, here we go with the tiebreaker, ladies. Push the button and reveal the two questions. Ask the challenger to make a selection.
I'm going to try B one more time.
Okay, B for Brooke Walker. Are you ready?
We're ready.
This is a tiebreaker. They get one chance, one question. Everyone laughed when Mark dived into the swimming pool because his blank came off. Everyone laughed when Mark dived into the swimming pool. Because his blank came off. All right, as soon as you're ready, Charles. There we go. Now they're all ready. So, Brooke, we call on you for your response. What came off?
His swimming trunk.
His swimming trunk?
And was he embarrassed?
I'm sorry about that. Nipsey, what came off?
Well, it was really no laughing matter because it's the little things that count. His trunk.
Okay. So there's one for you, Brooke. And Brett.
You know, I haven't matched anybody this week at all.
Well, I discussed that, right? Try another wig and maybe it'll happen.
It's Rug. Thinking of myself.
His rug came off. All right, Charles.
I was going to put that, but I have a little bit more pride about my self-image. His suit came off.
His suit came off. Is it off? Well, that's two. Beverly, what came off?
Suit.
His suit, another one. I didn't mean to put my medicine so close to you.
I'm just sticking right there.
Notice it's in a bigger bottle every time this disease progresses.
Richard,
look, the half soda is breaking down. We bent his funnel. Yes, his trunks did come off, and luckily his wife lowered the metals.
Trunk. That's four for you. Now let's see what we get from Betty White.
Trunk.
Okay. All right, Olivia, you've got your work cut out for you. Five to tie, six to win. Here we go.
Okay.
Ellen said, a most divine Italian man taught me how to make blank.
Ellen said, a most divine Italian man taught me how to make
What are you doing, Johnny Olsen?
You rascal, you.
Okay, lower tier is ready, and so is the upper tier. We'll come to Olivia. A most divine Italian man taught me how to make...
Love.
Okay.
Here now.
Well, that, you know, it's either love or spaghetti, so... What do you say, Nipsey?
I was thinking pizza, but I said love.
All right. Well, there's one. We need four to tie, Brett.
da 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 da.
You should really be in a musical. Then maybe you'll get off this show.
I don't speak English, so I say amore, love.
Amore. I see. Va bene. Okay. Bella ragazza, che cosa?
Well, I was thinking love, but yeah. I said pizza.
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 All right, now you've got to match.
I was thinking pizza, but I said love.
Let's see, it's 5-3. That's the correct score? Okay, you've got to match both people to stay in the game.
Three.
Oh,
I
got
to go.
Thank you.
Betty. You don't want to hear mine?
Oh, yes, I do want to hear yours.
Well, I'll go if you want me to.
No, I want you to stay.
I'll go.
I was going to say, I was going to say love and pizza. I say,
forget it.
Forget it.
Bid adieu to Olivia Lenke. How was the extra ride? Did you enjoy that?
Lovely.
Listen, did you enjoy your stay here?
Very much so.
I'm glad to hear that. You won $1,550. Congratulations.
Thank you, Olivia. Olivia Lenke. Now, go the other way. The other way. The other way. Go the other way.
And you see, I've been taking your medicine, Gene.
And don't come back.
What you got? You got off the merry-go-round just in time.
I was getting dizzy.
Now, you know how this part of it goes, a super match?
Yes, I do.
You have a go at the big money here?
Oh, boy.
You know, we polled a recent studio audience. We got their best response to this. Sweet blank. Now, the answer they gave most often is worth $500 to you if you match it. Second most frequent response, $250. And the third, $100. A little help from three celebrities. Choose three, one at a time.
Richard.
What do you say, Richard?
Present.
Yes, Richard. How do you fill in that blank?
Oh, sweet and sour.
Sweet and sour, he says. Another one?
Betty. Sweetheart.
Sweetheart. Okay. One more.
Nipsey.
Nipsey.
Sweet tooth.
Sweet tooth. So you've got sweetheart, sweet and sour, and sweet tooth. You may choose one of those or give us one of your own. What would you like to do?
I'll try sweetheart.
You'll try sweetheart?
All right. Thanks, I don't care for you.
Okay, sweetheart is the answer she's looking for, the one that Betty White gave her. Let's find out if it's up there. First, may we see the $100 response?
Sweet potato is a good answer. Nobody thought of that.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Ain't no such thing.
Okay. Still looking for a sweetheart. Here is the $250 response. Sweet tooth is up there, the one that Nipsey said.
Guilty.
Okay. Third and last chance, Brooke. Here is the $500 response.
Sweetheart.
Well done.
Well done.
Okay. So Brooke, you've got the $500 added to your previous winnings, and that means you play for 10 times that amount now, or $5,000. To collect the $5,000, you've got to match one celebrity on a head-to-head basis. It has to be an exact match. Which one will it be?
Betty again.
Oh, all right, Betty. You get ready to write. Here is the $5,000 question. Write your response to this, if you would, please. Last blank. L-A-S-T blank. Betty is finished, Brooke. Give us your response to this. Last
chance.
Last chance is her answer, Betty, for $5,000. May we see yours?
Could I give her $250 in cash?
Last chance.
Thank you.
But she's up to $5,600. She's got a big rooting section down here. We'll get back to her right after we pass along these messages to you.
He protects all the things in the forest. But he can't do it alone. Please don't play with matches. Put out your campfires. And never, ever forget the words of Smokey Bear.
Only you could prevent forest fires.
Okay, now we're going to start another game. Are you over the shakes?
Not quite.
Well, pull yourself together because you got another challenger to meet here.
All right.
Let's say hello to Sharon Moses. Hi, Sharon. Where are you from?
Los Angeles.
What do you do and all that?
Well, I'm an educational aide at 95th Street School, the wife of an actor, writer, and I have three sons.
A young girl like you with three children already?
Yes, I'm all of 18.
Okay, well, you look...
Doesn't look a day or 18 to me.
Good luck to you here, Sharon. I'll push the button and ask you to make a selection as we do the challenger at all times. What do you say?
I like A, please.
She likes A. New game here, folks, and this is it. Jane had a pygmy living in her blank.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jane had a pygmy living in her blank.
I never talked to her.
Don't think too hard, Charles. You're going to strain something. Charles is moving his lips. Ready. Okay, now they're all set. So, Sharon, we'll call on you. Jane had a pygmy living in her blank.
Jane had a pygmy in her house.
In her house.
In her house.
Okay. What say you to that? Jane had a pygmy living in her house.
Yeah, but he was just a little guy, so he took the smallest room. In her closet.
In her closet. No match there. Okay, house is her answer, Brett. What's yours?
Well, first I thought of bush, and then I thought of Tarzan, and then I thought tree.
In her tree.
Living in her tree.
You just got the buzz, Brett.
Charles?
She found him in a tree, then he moved to the closet. But when they go out, like to Vegas for a weekend, it's in the pocket.
Living in the pocket. Okay, he was a tiny one indeed. What do you say?
Well, it's just the way you said it. You know, when you said, Jane had a pygmy living in her blanket.
In her blanket?
Yeah, I mean, you said blank so well.
Yeah, I say that well. We use that word quite frequently around here.
All right. You don't use narcotics, do you?
Okay, Richard.
She had a little pygmy living in her cellar.
Downstairs there.
Poor little devil.
Low ceiling.
That was all the light
he did. He gets around.
Down there. Yes, indeed. Okay, Betty.
If he wants to get around, she had a pygmy living in her Volkswagen.
There it is. Well, Sharon, I'm sorry you didn't score with that.
Let's
see how Brooke goes with this. Here is Brooke's half of this round. The roller derby announcer said, Dirty Birthday is up to her old tricks again. She just dumped a bucket of blank all over the track.
Could you do that question just one more time?
The roller derby announcer said, Dirty Bertha is up to her old tricks again. She just dumped a bucket of blank all over the track. You know what a roller derby is, don't you?
It's where people are on roller skates.
That's right. Are you thinking about this?
Yes, I am.
All right. They're all ready.
Wait a minute. I've got it.
No, you haven't. I've got it.
I know three people she's getting
it. Okay, Brooke. Now it's up to you. Dirty Bertha's up to her old tricks again. She just dumped a bucket of blank all over the track.
Water,
she says. All right. I guess that would be a dirty trick. Dump water on the roller derby track. Nipsey.
Dirty Bertha was so mean that the rattlesnakes refused to bite her out of professional courtesy. She dumped a bucket of sand all over the track.
Sand would be bad also. Brett, her answer is water. What's yours?
You know what? You don't want to see my ass.
I don't want to see your ass.
I do. I don't think I'll see you in the dressing room. Derby manure.
Charles, would you bring some sanity back?
I'm from the legitimate theater, so I don't want to be associated with these people. I was in Hello, Dolly, and it was a wonderful line that said, blank is like money. It's no good unless you spread it around. Manure.
All right, Beverly.
Can you rescue a bucket of paint.
All right, water is her answer. What do you say, Richard?
I say, why don't we jump in the cab and get the hell out of here?
Okay.
What could I say with a pretty lady like that? But water.
There's a map. What do you say
there? Right back in the sand.
Put it back in the sand. Okay, so it's 1-0 in favor of the current champ at the end of round one. And who knows if round two will occur. I don't know. Find out after this word.
Being alone, so much lonelier at Christmas.
From the director of Sleepless in Seattle.
I wish there was someone who cared for me.
Comes a Christmas comedy.
Give up women, Pancho. Tomorrow he will. Ooh, that's gotta hurt.
That will put the joy back into your holiday.
My heart is racing and I'm feeling all nervous and sick.
That's the way I felt since the day I met you.
Steve Martin.
Catherine was very distressed, so naturally I had to comfort her.
Mixed Nuts, rated PG-13, at theaters December 21st.
They're still around, and these diseases could be life-threatening. Full protection takes around 5 visits for shots. Starting by 2 months and ending by age 2, ask if your baby is up to date on every visit to your doctor. Or if you don't have a doctor, call 1-800-232-2522 to find out where to get your baby shot. Your baby's counting on you.
$25,000 is hidden on stage. Will the contestants find it? Jeff Edwards paves the way during TV's wackiest treasure hunt. Next on Game Show Network.
All right, ladies. No, score is 1-0 in favor of Brooke Walker here at the end of round one. We'll go to round two and ask Sharon to make a selection.
I'm going to switch. B.
You're going to switch?
Yeah.
You want B this time?
Fine.
Sharon is switching, folks.
Okay.
Remember you heard me right.
Here we go. Here's a little poem.
Oh.
A poem. A raisin's a grape, and a prune is a plum. Jerry was startled and swallowed his blank. Does that rhyme? Shall I read it for you?
Once.
Okay. Only once? A raisin's a grape, and a prune is a plum. Jerry was startled and swallowed his blank. They're all ready. So, Sharon, would you like to complete the poem?
Yes. He swallowed his thumb.
Thumb. You're the...
How do you spell plum?
P-L-U-M.
P-H-L-U-M. What rhymes with plum? I thought swallowed his gum.
Gum? That's a good answer. That's okay, Nipsey. Nothing wrong with that. No match, but not a bad answer, Brett.
I thought actually bun or roll, but I didn't think that. I said thumb.
Gum. There's a match for Sharon. Charles?
I have to be with my friend Nipsey. Gum.
Gum. Okay.
See, I know it.
All right. Let's come down here to Pretty Beverly. What do you say?
I'm sticking to thumb.
Oh. Thumb. There's a name of you, Sharon. Richard?
Yeah, I happen to know that Jerry was a cannibal and he swallowed his mum.
Oh, right.
I would have been you to say that.
What do you
no,
say?
No, sir. His thumb.
Thumb. So that means you're up to 3. So it's 3-1 at this moment. Let's see if we, what we do with this. Now, you need 2 to tie, 3 to win, Brooke. Here we go.
Mrs. Houdini said, my Harry is a great magician. He can blank with both hands tied behind his back.
Richard's the only one who does not play. Everyone else plays.
Of course, I'm the best.
Now you play now. Come on. My Harry is a great magician. He can blank with both hands tied behind his back. Mrs. Houdini.
Magician?
Yes, Houdini.
You remember Harry Houdini.
Harry Houdini.
Well, that looks like, but I'll explain to you.
Okay. Charles, you're too young to remember Harry Houdini, aren't you?
Tony Curtis played him in the movie.
Okay.
Who won?
Everybody is ready, so Brooke will call on you. My Harry is a great magician. He can blank with both hands tied behind his back. What do you say?
Disappear.
He can disappear with both hands tied behind his back.
Your show.
Yes, it is my show.
What are you looking at us for?
Nipsey, what do you say?
I didn't say anything.
He can swim with both hands tied behind his back.
That's what he did. He was an escape artist.
That's right. All right, Brett, what did you say? You said you were going to explain yours.
But all he'd have to do with spelling. I love my answer. You're going to be crazy about it. It's the best answer I've given this week.
Well, that's not saying a lot.
I get you all counted out there. Touch me.
He can touch you.
I mean, with both hands
tied behind his back. Yeah. A neat trick. Okay. No, it's all right.
You thought I was bad.
No. Charles,
make love with both hands.
Make love. You must match Beverly and Betty now to stay in the game. Beverly, may we see yours? Her answer is disappear.
Oh, that's a shame. Mine is
disappear. Two to two. You need one more to achieve a tie.
Well, no, we're going to have a little meeting over there in the corner. Escape.
Escape and disappear.
Oh, wait, no.
No match. So Sharon.
$100 for you. Well, Brooks, I'm sorry to see you go, but you're not going to go empty-handed because you won a lot of money, $5,600, and it was a pleasure having you here.
Thank
Brooks
you.
Walker.
Thank you.
Are you ready?
I'm scared to death.
You have nothing to be scared of. Well, I'll tell you what, while you're getting unscared, we'll pass along a little message here, and that'll give you a chance to cool off. Be right back.
Jeanine woke up in a cold sweat with one thing echoing through her brain. Who is this guy in her bathroom?
Meanwhile, Barry was thinking, whose bathroom am I in?
Jeanine remembered going to the party the night before and getting smashed out of her mind.
Barry remembered getting drunk and acting really stupid.
Eventually,
the whole evening came back.
Oh, I must be really stupid.
I must be really dumb.
What did I do? How did I get myself into this?
What did I do? How did I get myself into this?
What about...
What about Ace?
Then they both realized, much to their relief, that unlike the rest of us...
They were just cartoons.
Get high.
Get stupid.
Get AIDS.
Gene Rayburn saying so long from Action 73. Join us next time. Bye.
Today's consolation prizes are from Montgomery Ward's Christmas catalog. Exhilarated four-car slotless electric road race set. Plenty of fun and action for all ages from the Montgomery Ward catalog. And an assortment of trouble aftershave and cologne gift sets. Trouble has a scratch and sniff spot on the outside for you to smell what's inside. And a supply of Swiss Miss Instant Cocoa Mix made with real miniature marshmallows and good non-fat dry milk already in it. You just add water. This is Johnny Olson speaking for Match Game 73, a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production.
You're watching Game Show Network.